So welcome to the third lecture of the second day of the students training on artificial intelligence and machine learning. And in this particular lecture, I'll be talking about the classification process. Now, in the morning session, I have discussed about the introduction to machine learning. And there you have seen that one of the objectives of the machine learning technique or algorithm is to allow the system to learn by itself. So in other words, if I would like to represent the system by means of a black box, so this is the machine learning system. And we have a set of training data available to this system, and we expect the system to learn by itself from the input-output data available to it or provided to it. So this is nothing but a set of input, test input and test output, say x1, y1, x2, y2, up to say xm, ym. Suppose there are m number of such data, and we want the system to provide a particular learning algorithm, a particular program to be obtained or available at its output. So that is the requirement from our side. Now suppose, let us consider a situation like this, where this x versus y can be represented on a graph like this. So I am considering that both x and y, they are single dimensional, and the concept could have been extended for multi-dimensional data as well. So suppose this is the input variable, this axis corresponds to the output variable, and suppose we have got a few training data. Suppose this is one training data identified by this blue dot. There is another training data over here. Another training data. So this is the fourth one. So they are randomly distributed over this space, just like this. So this is nothing but the set of x and y. Now in the second lecture, we have discussed about the regression model and linear regression model, where the objective is to find out a function f in such a way that this expected value of y cap can be represented like f of x. Now in case of a linear regression model, what we have observed is this x and y, they are related by means of some straight line. So what I can do is I can try to fit the data by means of a straight line. Depending upon the value of x and y, one can select the straight line to be like this. Let this be the straight line. But even in this case, you find that there are few points, a few data points which are lying exactly on the straight line, and there are a few data points which are not lying on the data points. They are outside this particular straight line. So the points are not falling on the straight line. So as a matter of fact, one can say that this straight line is a suboptimal solution in this regard. In other words, you will find that there are certain distances, which is nothing but the error count. So for this one, for this particular data point, the corresponding value will be something like this. I think I can erase this particular data point, because for a single x, we have two different y. So suppose, let me mark this point over here. I should also erase this point, because for a single x, we are having two different y. Anyway, so suppose this is one point on this two-dimensional axis. There's another point over here, like this. So for different x, we are getting different y, just like this. Now we find that out of this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 data points, 3 points are lying exactly on the straight line and 5 points are not lying on the straight line. Some of the points are lying above the straight line and some of the lines are falling below the straight line. But anyway, if I consider a linear regression kind of model, hopefully this is the best estimation what I can get from this particular model. But what we find is the difference between the corresponding data point and the estimated value is not at all zero. Sometimes it is zero. For example, if I consider this particular point, so this particular point is falling on the straight line, this point. This point is falling on the straight line. So in this particular case, the prediction error will be zero. This point is also falling on the straight line. So here also, the prediction error will be zero. And here also, the prediction error will be zero. But however, if I consider this particular data point, now here, if I follow this straight line, so I need to find out what is the projected value on the straight line. So this projected value for this given x, if x is this much, then y is this much. So following the straight line, the point on the straight line is the estimated value. And this is the actual value. Actual value is identified by this blue dot, and the estimated value is obtained on this particular straight line. So this is the error which has been observed over here. So the error signal can be represented by the actual value y during the testing process and minus the predicted value, that is y cap. So y cap can be obtained just by putting the value of x in this particular function, y is equal to fx. Now if I consider that this blue point is coming from a testing data, so in that case this will be the corresponding error, and here the prediction, I mean y is higher as compared to y cap, so error will be positive. Here also error will be positive because it is above the straight line. However, for these three cases, the error will be negative because the estimated value is large as compared to the actual value. So the inability of this particular model, linear regression model, to exactly fit all the data points is known as the bias in machine learning paradigm. So this is known as the bias. This particular phenomenon is known as the bias. So what do you mean by bias? Bias is nothing but the inability. Bias is known as the inability of this linear model, or any model I should say, inability of capturing the data points properly in any environment. So this is the bias. So here the bias is essentially identified by the difference. So if the difference is more, that means the actual value and the predicted value, if the difference is more, then obviously it's also more.
Sir,
any confusion?
Yes, sir. Sir, can we find as a perpendicular distance between the point and the given line?
Yeah.
So that can also be the error.
Okay, I'm telling you the fact. This is the straight line. So y is equal to fx, I'm considering, and fx is a straight line over here. Now suppose this is a test point. This is a state point, this particular point. Suppose I think I can use a different color. Using a different color, I can show. So during test, I know that this is the particular coordinate. Let it be x star, comma y star. That means I know that If the input is x star, the output should be y star, and this is a particular coordinate. But this y star is not known to me. To the machine learning system, y star is not known to us. Whenever this machine learning system is trying to find out the value of y star from the given x star, initially this machine learning algorithm has to undergo a rigorous training set. So in fact, let me tell you, there are two different phases. The first phase is a training phase, where a number of training data are being provided. Training phase. And the second phase is a testing phase. So I have to check whether the training is perfect or not. Testing phase. So just like our examination system, initially there is a span of 6 months or 1 year for the study of any particular subject or course. So this is known to be the training phase, and whether the training is perfect or not, we have to check by means of some evaluation method, and that is known as a testing or test or semester examination. So same thing is also applicable here in machine learning. Initially, the system is trained with a number of data points. So as many numbers as possible, let there be n number of such data points are there. And accordingly, we are allowing the ML system to train by its own. And then some unknown data points. So we know that x star is the input and the corresponding output is y star. But this y star is unknown to the system, just like our semester examination, the question paper. As an examiner, we know for this particular question, this is the correct answer, this is the right answer. But whenever we are here to judge your performance, then the input x star, the question x star is known to you, but the output is not known to you. May be known to you, may not be known to you. Now, in order to obtain the output, what you do, you take the input x star and you recall all of your previous experience into account from your memory, and accordingly the output will be developed, and the output can be y star cap that may not be called y star. Then how to find out this y star cap? Already you have got this linear function, that is y is equal to fx. Now if this is the x value, if this is the x value, x star, so how can you get x star? So let me project it. This is x star value. So this value is x star, and already we know the function y is equal to fx. So how to find out the value? How to find out y star cap? So
we will extend the line.
You have to extend to this line, yes, and you intersect over here, and that value is y star cap.
Y star.
Right. I would request all of you to kindly mute your microphone. If you have anything to ask, you can put it in the chat box itself. Anyway, I'll try to clarify all of your query. So this will be your y star cap, the intercept, this particular point, and the difference between y star and y star cap is nothing but the error, and which you would like to minimize. However, depending upon this deviation from the actual value, we can devise different types of regression model. So here I have shown a very simplest kind of regression model that is known as a linear regression, for which the mathematical part has been discussed in the last lecture, last module. So this is known to be the bias, the inability of the system or particular model to capture the data points properly in any particular environment. Now your objective is to minimize the bias. What is our objective? Objective should be the minimization of the bias. Minimization of bias. That should be the objective, so that it can properly capture the data points. But however, it is almost impossible given the data points which are distributed on this two-dimensional space. So here I'm assuming that both the input and output, they're single dimensional. That means we have only one input, x, the scalar quantity, and for a single x, we'll be getting a single y. And so they're randomly distributed like this. So you must appreciate that under no circumstances, it will be possible to design a straight line which can fit this data set or all the data points in present environment. So obviously this kind of linear regression is providing a very high amount of bias, but our objective is the minimization of that particular bias. So that is one situation. So let me consider another situation, another case, where we find that the model is not at all a linear one. Rather, we have a squiggly line model like this. Let me tell you, suppose these are the few data points. These are the few data points in my hand. And suppose I have developed, let there be another point. And I have developed one squiggly line model so that it looks something like that. So I have designed, I have developed a model like this. Sorry. Okay, I think, let me put it over here. And suppose the model looks like this. So somehow I have developed a model like this, which touches all the data points accordingly. This is a squiggly line approximation. So in this case, you must appreciate that the corresponding bias value is zero for the training data set. For the training data set, since it touches all the data points, suppose this is x1, y1, this is x2, y2, this is x3, y3, x4, y4, x5, y5, and so on. Since it touches all the data points under training phase, so the bias is zero. Bias is minimum, or zero, I can say, if possible, bias is minimum for training data set. For training data set, the bias is zero. That is fine. But the story doesn't end here. You have designed the machine learning system, you have developed the machine learning system to make sure that it will perform well in some unknown situation when the input is different. That is the purpose of learning. The purpose of learning is to ensure that you remember the situation action pair in your mind, in your brain, so that you can behave perfectly in known situation. But even if the situation is unknown, if you're intelligent enough, then accordingly, depending upon the previous experience and the situation action pair, which is stored into your mind, you can provide the corresponding decision. So apart from this line, apart from these points, so under the testing phase, we could have the data points corresponding to different other x. Suppose this is one data point on the testing phase. This is another data point, for example. Suppose this is another data point. This is another data point over here, for example. So these are the testing data points. So blue lines are blue dots. So blue dots are representing the training phase, the training data set. And these green dots, they are for testing. They are for testing. So we find that even if the bias is zero or minimum under this particular model for the training data set, but the corresponding variation is significant when the testing data set has been provided to the system. And this particular phenomenon is known as, or this particular property is known as the high variability or high variance. High variability or high variance. That means the performance of this particular model is good. It's perfectly okay for training data set because it touches all the data points. However, it performs terribly when the data set has been changed from training to testing. On the other hand, if I take a look at this particular linear model or linear regression model, here you see that the bias is non-zero, obviously, high bias as compared to the squiggly line approximation. But however, if I change the data point from training to testing, suppose let me now incorporate the data points under testing condition. Suppose these are the data points. This is another data point over here. So once again, this corresponds to the testing data point. This is another data point, for example. So as you see, even under the testing condition, the corresponding error is not zero. But however, the performance is not that bad. It is not good. It is not perfectly good. But at the same time, we must appreciate that the performance is not that bad. So for this linear model, we can say that bias is high. That is the disadvantageous part. The variance is low. What do you mean by variance? So variance is the variability of the performance from one data set to the another data set. When this ML system is experiencing, ML system supported by a linear model is experiencing training data set, it gives you a certain result. When the same training system, same ML system supported by linear model is provided with a testing data set, if I calculate the overall error, total error, or overall error, or average error, you'll find that as far as the average error is concerned, for each of the two data sets, the result is almost comparable. So this particular regression model will give you low variance because the performance is so-so under training and testing condition. So that means the variability is less. On the other hand, if I consider this squiggly line approximation, here you find that the performance is very good under training data set because the bias is minimum, ideally zero. However, under testing data set, there is a high chance that this particular approximation behaves terribly bad, and which gives rise to high variance because the performance in one sense, in one case, is very good. And if I change the data set, then the performance becomes very bad. It also happens to a set of students. Suppose they have studied any particular course, suppose a course on engineering mechanics or any course on computer programming, and it is found that if they are provided with a particular question paper, say set number one, they are performing very well. They are getting, say, 80% marks, 90% marks, very good. But if the question pattern or question paper has been changed, same syllabus, but the question pattern or question paper has been changed, and it is found that their performance is terribly bad, suppose 40% or 50% on an average. So I can say that since the performance varies significantly based on the input data set, whether the question pattern one or question paper two, so I can't say that it provides a very good variance, rather a high variance or bad performance in this regard. So squiggly line does this thing, and this entire phenomenon in machine learning paradigm is known as bias variance trade-off. This is a very important notion, bias variance trade-off. Bias variance trade-off. Let me mention our objective. Our objective is to minimize the bias as much as possible and minimize the variance as well. But you cannot achieve these two properties together. So that's why you have to make a trade-off always in selecting any of the machine learning techniques or classification techniques. Now, with this in mind, let us go to the discussion on a classification model. So to start with, let me consider that we do have only one variable, and by means of which we can basically classify them into two different classes. Suppose this is the axis. So now my data point is a single dimensional. So only one dimension is here to start with. Suppose this gives the mass of an animal, mass of say mass of rat, for example. And we have carried out this experiment, and accordingly we have gathered the data points, and accordingly we are putting them on this particular axis. Suppose this is the one point. Okay, I think I should change the color. Oh. Right, so suppose this is one point. This is another point. So suppose I have performed this experiment on a set of, say, 100 such rats, and accordingly I have calculated their mass and putting them on this particular axis. So these are the different data points, single dimensional. And suppose these are the another set of data points obtained from the same experiment, might be there is something in between over here. Now, based on these data points, suppose our objective is to classify them into two different sets. One is the obese mouse, and the second one is not obese. So obviously for obese mouse, the mass will be pretty large, and for not obese mouse, the mass will be pretty small. So how to distinguish them into two different classes? One is obese, second one is not obese. Let it be say O and NO. So these are the O and O bar. So I think it will be better if I designate obese by O and not obese by O bar. So these are the two sets, and I would like to classify the rats accordingly depending upon their weight, mass. So how to categorize? So obviously we should have a threshold, since we require to classify them, categorize them into two different classes. So accordingly I require one threshold, and I need to put the threshold in such a way that in one side of the threshold all the rats whose mass is pretty large will be there, all the obese rats will be there, and on the other hand, on the other side of the threshold, we expect that all the rats whose mass is not that much, so it will be there. So accordingly I can put a threshold over here. So I can put a threshold anywhere in between. So I can put the threshold over here at this particular point. So for the sake of clarity, I have used two different colors. These green colors are used, green points are used to identify that these are not obese, and the red points, red data points are used to identify that these rats are obese. So obviously your intuition says that I can select any point in between these two lines. So what would happen if I select it over here? Let me place the threshold over here. Suppose this is my threshold. What happens? I can select it anywhere. And under this condition, this is the threshold. So then what we find is, if this is the threshold, so it corresponds to a particular mass value, let it be m star. And if the mass of any rat is higher than m star, I can classify them to be into the obese state. And if it is less than m star, I can classify them into the not obese state. In this regard, there is another terminology associated with this machine learning technique, which is known as the margin. So what is meant by margin? So margin is nothing but the shortest distance between the threshold and the observations. So we have different observations over here. So these are the different observations, and this is the threshold. So I can find out the margin as the shortest distance between the threshold and the observation. So in this side, we'll find this is the margin, because this is the shortest distance from this particular data point. And on that side, this will be the margin. So here the margin is not uniform. In one side margin is less, in other side margin is more. So before I proceed further, I think I should write what is meant by margin. So margin is identified as shortest distance between the threshold and the observations. Between the threshold and the observations. This is margin. So this will be the margin in this side, and this will be the margin that side. Now what if a new testing data point is obtained over here? Suppose let me consider, so this green and red are for the training data set. Now after I consider that this dotted line signifies the threshold as per my choice, then my classification might be over. Then suppose this particular black point corresponds to a testing data point. Now as far as our algorithm goes, we should say that since this black dot is appearing on the right hand side of this threshold, that means the corresponding mass is higher than the threshold value, so we should classify them as obese because it is higher than m star. So it should be class. So I should make a note over here, this is m star, this value is m star, the corresponding threshold value is m star, the threshold value, for example. Now, since this corresponding mass is higher than m star, so I should classify them as obese. However, if we compute the bias and if we compute the variance, then the answer will be clear to us whether this particular decision of making or keeping the threshold over here is correct or not. Now, if you calculate the variance, then you'll see that the variance of this data point with respect to these green lines or green dots will be less as compared to the variance of this particular data point with respect to those red points. In other words, I can say that since this particular testing data set identified by this black dot is close to the green dots, so it is customary to include them all into the not obvious state. That means into the state O bar. But however, I have selected the threshold in such a way which gives me a wrong notion about the class of this new testing data set. So what goes wrong actually? In fact, what we have done during the selection of this threshold, we have not maximized the margin. Here we find that the distance from this particular data point to the threshold is very small, whereas the distance from this particular data point to this threshold is pretty large. So we have not maximized the margin. And as a matter of fact, this misclassification may take in place. Obviously, under this present condition, if I place the threshold at this particular point, and if the testing data is on the other side of this threshold, then obviously you are going to make a wrong decision. You may think that that particular rat is obese, belonging to this set O, although it should belong into the set O bar. So accordingly, we have to change selecting the particular threshold position, keeping in mind that the distance between the data points over here, I mean data points on the margin, and the distance between the threshold and the data point over here should be the same. Or in other words, we would like to maximize the margin value. So that could have been done if I just replace. I think it will be better if I just once again draw the same structure. So this is the mass, let it be M, and these are the data points. So far, we have not considered this maximal margin. So these are the data points in one side. And which is belonging to the set O bar. And it belongs to O. So I have to put the threshold. So obviously I can put the threshold anywhere in between this particular range. So previously I have selected the threshold value arbitrarily anywhere in between. Similarly, I can also put the threshold very close to this particular data point. So in which case another type of misclassification will take place. So now here the objective is to maximize the margin. So I have to consider the data points lying on the edge. So this is the closest data point on one side, and this is the closest data point on the other side. So to find out what is the distance between them, and I have to put the threshold in between. So that will be the ideal thresholding under this condition. So here, this is the margin. In one side, as I already told you, margin is nothing but the shortest distance between the threshold and the observation. I think it seems that it is not equal. So I think to be precise, it will be better if I put it over here so that it is exactly in the middle. Suppose this is the point. So let me draw. So this is the threshold axis. So this is the threshold. So this is the margin on one side, and this is the margin on the other side. So eventually, you find that this margin, let it be say W1 and W2. Now we find that W1 and W2, these are equal. And as a matter of fact, this particular classifier is known as maximal margin classifier. Maximal margin classifier. Maximal margin classifier. So that is fine. Now, under normal condition, this maximal margin classifier will perform properly. There is no doubt about that. If we find the data points which are there in the right hand side close to this particular cluster, so this maximal margin classifier will classify them as always red. And if the data points lying over here, so accordingly this maximal margin classifier will classify them as not obvious, belonging to this Obart set. But what happens to the outliers? What do you mean by outliers? Suppose, for example, we may find testing data point lying over here. So eventually we expect that these red points, red dots, should be lying very close to this cluster. But there could have been some outlier, some peculiar behavior might be there, and we can expect that some data point lying over here at this particular point. It is expected to be at this particular position. However, because of the large variance, the data point is located at this particular point, or the other way around. You can also expect that some data point to be located at this particular point, crossing the threshold value. Then what happens? Now, if this is the scenario, then obviously, what you need to do is, you have to once again change the corresponding threshold value. In other words, let me show you a different perspective. Sorry. I think there has been certain problem with the PowerPoint. I believe that you can watch the screen. So since this was lost, so I think I may start drawing the diagram very quickly. So as I was mentioning, this is the mass. And accordingly, we have already pointed out the data points. Two data points over here. And there could have been some data points. Over here. So accordingly, one can fix the threshold in between. And the two classes can be identified. This is the obese class, and this is the not obese class. Now, however, there could have been some outlier for which we can expect that the not obese point, suppose it is very close to the obese point. Suppose the mass of the rat is such that it can be regarded as not obese. So accordingly, I am marking this by means of this green point. Now under this condition, if I mark it with a green point, green dot, so I cannot put the threshold at this particular point, because there you will find that in one side of the threshold, all the green dots are there, and on the other side, most of the red dot, or almost all the red dot and one green dot is present. So accordingly, I need to change the location of the threshold. So now the margin will be this much. So what happens is, so threshold position will be modified, and this will be the new margin. This will be the new margin. And assuming that maximal margin classifier, I have to place the threshold over here. So what we find is this maximal margin classifier is very much sensitive to the outliers in the training data. Depending upon the outliers, obviously you must argue that this particular data point, it is supposed to be here, very close to this cluster, because it is a set, it is a data set corresponding to the not obese rat. However, this is the outlier. Since it's outlier, so that's why it has been placed over here. So the selection of the threshold is very much dependent on the outliers. The same could have been true if some red data points come over here. Then also, I have to change the position of the threshold line. So this is one of the disadvantages of this maximal margin classifier. So I have already discussed about this one, maximal margin classifier. But since it was lost, so I think it will be better if I write it down. Maximal margin classifier. So the disadvantage of this is that it is super sensitive to outliers. So depending upon the position of the outliers in the training data set, the position of the threshold will be modified. So it is super sensitive to the outlier in the training data set. So this is one of the disadvantages. And we do not know how many outliers will be there in a set of data. So we need to get rid of this particular situation. So what could have been the possible way out? The possible way out is that we can allow misclassification. In other words, what I mean to say is, previously, the threshold was put at this particular point, and accordingly, the rats could have been classified properly as obese or not obese. But since, because of the presence of this outlier data point over here, I need to change the position of the threshold, and accordingly, the threshold has been put over here. And under this condition, if the threshold is put over here, then you'll find that in one side of the threshold, all the rats are there who are obese, and on the other side of the threshold, all the rats are there which are not obese. So if I change the threshold or position of the threshold, then there is no such misclassification. What is your objective? I should focus to keep all the green points in one side of the threshold and all the red points on the other side of the threshold. But in doing that, I have to always change the position of the threshold, and which is not at all possible practically. So the people have thought to allow certain misclassification. So people have thought that, okay, we can allow certain misclassification. That means even if I place the threshold at this particular point, okay, I'll find that out of six data sets, or out of six data sets, five has been already properly identified. However, this is misclassified. That means if I put the threshold at this particular point as previously, then you'll see that out of six green dot, five green dots have been properly identified or classified. However, this green dot is misclassified because it is on the other side of the threshold. Now, without changing the position of the threshold, one can allow misclassification. And this is an example of this bias variance trade-off, as we have discussed already. Now, when we allow this misclassification, then the distance between the observation and the threshold is called a soft margin. So now, the margin is not fixed. And if we allow this misclassification, so the solution is that, solution is to get rid of this particular situation, one has to allow misclassification. Although our goal is to minimize this misclassification, but if I go for zero misclassification, then it will be very difficult to figure out the threshold. Depending upon the value of the outliers, so the threshold will always switch from one position to the another position. So the only solution is to allow certain misclassification. And under this condition, when you allow this misclassification, the distance between the observations and the threshold is called a soft margin. So unlike a hard margin or simple margin, I can say if we allow if misclassification is allowed, if misclassification is allowed, the distance between the observations and the threshold is called a soft margin. This is soft margin, so it is not fixed. However, let me write down the definition for margin, because the previous slide, it was there, now it is lost. So margin is nothing but the shortest distance. This is the shortest distance between the threshold and the observation. And observations. Anyway, so when you allow this misclassification, so the notion of soft margin is there, then you must argue that where to place this threshold under the paradigm of soft margin. So accordingly, you have to perform some cross validation to determine how many misclassification and observations are there to be allowed inside the sort margin to get the best classification. That means even if the green point is over here, now you are making this particular threshold, the dotted line, so you are making it a variable one. So you have to change this, you have to vary the position of this particular dotted line, the position of the threshold, in such a way so as to cross-validate that how many misclassification is there and how many proper observation is there under the paradigm. Under this particular case, if I put the threshold over here, I'll find that out of so many data, so many data points, only one misclassification is there and the other data points are properly classified. Now, if you are happy with this kind of result, that obviously we expect that the misclassification should be as small as possible, and our objective is to increase the classification, the number of properly classified data points. Now, under this condition, one can say that if the misclassification is small and out of the total number of observations, then this particular sort margin might be acceptable to some extent. So our objective is to get the best classification out of that. So when this sort margin, notion of sort margin is used to get a threshold, then this is known as, this concept is known as sort margin classifier or support vector classifier. So when this sort margin is there to determine the threshold, so this is known as sort margin classifier. Sort margin classifier. This is known as sort margin classifier or support vector classifier. Sort margin classifier or support vector classifier. Assuming that the observations which are there on the edge or within the sort margin, they are acting as support vectors. Now, this support vector classifier, obviously can, it can handle outliers. And at the same time, we allow certain misclassification and obviously some overlapping classification. So might be for this support vector classifier, I think it will be better if I go to the next slide. So if I consider support vector classifier with the number of data points, so here it is not fixed. So depending upon the result of cross validation, you have to finally freeze the data point, I mean the margin, and accordingly the threshold. So here my purpose is to incorporate as many data points as possible. So there are different data points. This for the not obese, and the red dots are for the obese. So suppose these are the data points. So I can select this threshold over here. If I consider this is the one point, this is the furthest point from my understanding, and this is another one. So accordingly, this gives rise to twice the margin. And if I consider this is 2x, so I can find out what is x in between. So I can put it over here, assuming that these two values are same. W1 and W2. Suppose this to be same, W1 equal W2. So that could have been regarded as support vector classifier. But obviously, as you understand, this is not at all. So this is an example of support vector classifier. Support vector classifier. So as you see, the support vector classifier, the position of the threshold is not at all sensitive to the outliers. Even if some green point, data point is lying over here, but the threshold has not been shifted. Or in other words, even if the red data point is there in this left-hand side, very close to the set not OBs, still this threshold has not been shifted. So it is not at all that sensitive to the outliers. Or in other words, I can say that the support vector classifier can handle the outliers. It can manage the outliers to some extent, unlike your maximal margin classifier. And obviously, it was our initial assumption to include some classification to get rid of the problem associated with maximal margin classifier. So obviously, the support vector classifier will allow certain misclassification, as you observe over here. So here you see that altogether 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So 10 data points are there on the right-hand side, and out of them, 9 are properly classified, and this is misclassified, this green one. And on the other hand, if I consider this side, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, out of 14, only one is misclassified, the others are properly classified. So if you are happy with this kind of behavior of your classifier, that it is true that the support vector classifier allows some misclassification. And if you are happy with that, if you can go with that, then that is fine. And obviously some overlapping classifier, as you can see, is green and red. So there is an overlapping kind of thing. So support vector classifier can handle all these things. But the next question is that, so I think I should write, what does this support vector classifier possess? So the support vector classifier, in short, SVC, support vector classifier, SVC, it can handle outliers. It can handle outliers. That means it is not at all sensitive to the outliers. And at the same time, it can allow misclassification. This is the fundamental point to start with. Allow misclassification and overlapping classifications. And allow overlapping classifications. Now, if the overlapping classifications, now, if the number of overlap is less, then we should be happy with that. But if there are more number of overlappings, so under this condition, we should not be happy with the support vector classifier. So here we find that only 1 and 1, 2. 2 misclassification and some overlapping classification has taken place over here. So I may be happy with this kind of performance of support vector classifier. But if there are tons and tons of overlaps, then how to get rid of that? That means if there are more than one red dot, suppose there are say 10 red dots over here and 7 green dots over here. So in that case, you will see that the true positive and the true negative is almost becoming comparable, or false negative and false positive, they are becoming almost comparable. So under this condition, the performance of the support vector classifier is not at all acceptable. And so we need to get some new device, some new mechanism to get rid of that. and that is known as a support vector machines. So if you open any book on the support vector machines or support vector classifier, you will find that there are lots and lots of mathematics, but considering the fact that you are from different background, so I have tried to make it as simple as possible to get rid of any mathematics. Anyway, but this field is overflooded with lots of mathematics. Anyway, so first of all, let me write down the name first. It's a very important topic, support vector machine. Support vector machine classifier or SVM classifier. Now let us take a simple example for that to understand the notion of support vector machine. Suppose I would like to identify the drug dosage to any patient from any particular severe problem. And that could have been measured with respect to the amount of drug in milligram, for example. So as you understand, to cure any patient from any particular disease, the amount which should be prescribed by the physician should not be very small, and it should not be very large. That means it should be within the prescribed limit. Now, if the total consumption of the particular drug is like very small, in that case, we can expect that that patient will not be cured from the disease. And if some patient takes too many medicines, then also there could have been some side effects. So in which case we can also say that the patient is not cured. So there is a prescribed limit of this medicine intake. So I am trying to represent the medicine intake in terms of the milligram, the total amount of milligram being consumed by the patient. So as I've already mentioned, if we have like a prescribed limit, suppose the prescribed limit is say 100 to 200 milligram in a week, for example, or in a month, then the patient is cured. So I would like to identify them on this graph, the perfect dose. And suppose if the dosage small, then the patient may not be cured. And on the other hand, if the dose is very large, then might be there is certain side effects, then also it is not cured, patient is not cured. So this is overdose. Here we find this is underdose. And this one is the perfect prescribed limit. This is the prescribed limit. This is the prescribed limit. So now, if we apply the support vector classifier, for example, in this particular case, so in no way you will find a solution. You have to place the threshold. You find that there are tons and tons of overlapping over here. After this rate, you have these green data points, and once again, you have the red data points. So you'd like to find out by means of a single line or by means of a single point, we have to identify. Or we have to classify them into two different classes. We have to categorize them into two different classes. But it is not possible here under the present circumstances. So what a support vector machine does is from a single dimensional data. So here I have considered that this classification has to be carried out on the basis of a single dimension. I mean, the data is a single dimensional, the a milligram of dosage of the drug, the medicine. And what a support vector machine has prescribed is, let us increase the dimension to solve this particular problem. So we start with a single dimension. Okay. So if this is x, then let this be x square. So this axis represents y, where y is equal to say x square. Under this condition, you can easily find out the value depending upon this value. So this is the x value. What should be the x square? You can find out. Okay, this will be the x square value. This will be x square, and this will be x square. For example, let it be little bit less to fit all the points. Let it be there for this point, the corresponding x square for this point. This is the corresponding x square value, and then for this 5, I can draw over here like this one, then this one, and for them this one like this. Actually, they will follow parabolic nature. And on the other hand, if I consider this prescribed limit, you will find that they might be positioned over here, the y square value. I think it should be even less to fit all of them into a single graph. So they will follow a parabolic nature. And for this prescribed limit, we can also find out the value. So I think it will be better if I draw the parabola first. Otherwise, it will be painful for me to draw the graph. I think it will be better if I draw the parabola first. Otherwise, it seems that it is like a straight line. Anyway, to some extent, I need to draw. So accordingly, I can put the points now. It will be convenient for me now to put the points on this parabola. Suppose this is the point corresponding to the first data point, for the second data point, third data point, over here. And over here, I can put the points over here, and so on. And for those green data points, which are for the prescribed limit, I can put them over here. So these are the points. Now, since the data has been now represented on two dimensional axis, one x and second one is x square, the previous we have seen that since we have a single dimension, we can segregate by means of a single point, which is known as a threshold point. And if the testing value is higher than the threshold, we should consider them to be included into a particular set. And if not, then to include it into another set. Now here, since the data has been represented in a two-dimensional plane, so obviously it is not possible to segregate the data points using a single point. Rather, we need to use a line to segregate them into two different classes. So accordingly, let me just show the line. For example, I don't know whether it will be perfectly drawn or not. Anyway, if I can draw the line, straight line like this, we segregate. So I think it's okay now. So this is the line. So this line will classify these data points into two different classes. So this is the corresponding threshold, and the support vector machine will eventually find out a support vector classifier by means of this particular line, and this line will segregate the data points into two defined sets. All the red data points are above this line and all the green data points are below this line. So given any arbitrary data point, suppose some arbitrary data point is positioned over here, anything over here, I don't know what should be the corresponding output at this particular point, because might be prescribed within the prescribed limit or might be an overdose. So if I do not know what should be the output, so this is the testing point, for example. So accordingly, I need to find out what will be the value of this x square just by putting this x value on y is equal to x square. That means it will cut this particular parabola in this particular point. And then we have to check whether the corresponding value of y, which is lying on the parabola, whether it is above the straight line or not. If it is above the straight line, we can readily classify it to be into the overdose state. That means the patient is not cured. And on the other hand, if I find that the value of the y is less than y such that it is less than this straight line, below the straight line, I can consider it to be included into the set not obese or O bar. So accordingly, we can define two different data sets. So O means, so here I can write the patient cured means 2D points below the straight line. And patient not cured means 2D points above the straight line. So accordingly, we can have two different classes, class 1 and class 2. So this is the operation which is being performed by the support vector machine. So if I would like to write down the algorithm of the support vector machine classifier, so what should be the actual algorithm for any support vector machine classifier algorithm for SVM classifier? First, you start with a relatively lower dimension. So for the present example, the dimension was only 1 to start with. Start with relatively lower dimension. Then the second one is, the second step is move the data to a relatively higher dimension, as we have done with y is equal to x squared. Move the data to a higher dimension. And then finally, find the support vector classifier. Find the support vector classifier. So these are the three steps in short. Now we can always start with a relatively lower dimension, no problem. But the question is that how to move the data to a higher dimension. As you know, we have started with y is equal, we have started with x, the drug dosage, and we have used y is equal to x squared. And then the obvious question is that why not y is equal to x cube or x to the power 4 or any other function of x to make it to the higher dimension. So in order to decide what function has to be used, now the support vector machine uses some function called a cardinal function, which can systematically find the support vector classifier in higher dimension. Now, before I say anything about this, the cardinal function, let me tell you that in this particular case, we have considered that we do have the data points in one dimension only. That means the drug dosage, if I once again go back, that drug dosage, this is as a function, I mean, it has been represented in terms of milligram, and this is the only variable by means of which we can classify the patient to be cured or not cured. Similarly, for the rat example, we have got like the mass of the rat, and accordingly we have to classify into obese or not obese. So sometimes, as you know, in order to identify whether the rat is obese or not obese, the age factor is also important. So under this condition, instead of having a single dimension as your feature vector or as your feature, we could also include more than one feature. For example, if I would like to compute the mass of different rats, then age has to be taken into consideration. Otherwise, we cannot decide whether that particular rat is obese or not. So otherwise, we will be making some wrong decision in this regard. So apart from the age, I mean, apart from the mass, the age can also be taken into consideration. Say, for example, this is the mass, and this is age. And accordingly, I can put the data points over here for defined values of. We can expect that when the age is small, the mass is expected to be small, quite natural. And when the age is large, age is high, then the mass is expected to be large. And after a certain time, you find that the age is remaining constant, but mass is going to increase. So then it signifies the obese rat, just like this. So apart from a single variable to classify the rats into two different classes, so here there are two classes. First class was obese, and the second one was not obese. So instead of taking a single variable like the mass, we can also consider two variables. And if one wish, one can also incorporate the other variables as well. So here I am considering only two variables, the mass and the age, to classify those rats into two different classes, like O and O bar. Now, when you consider the mass only, or when you consider a single variable only, we know that the threshold is a point, because it has been represented on a single axis, on x axis, and threshold is a point, and by means of which we can classify those rats into two different classes. But what would happen if it is not a single dimensional data, rather two dimensional data like this, mass and age? And sometimes we can have a three dimensional data, mass, age, and say height, for example. So under this condition, if we have a single dimensional data, then the threshold will be a single point, as we have already discussed. So if the input is a single dimensional data, then the threshold is a single point, m star, for example. If it is higher than m star, then in one class, and less than m star in another class. And if it is a two dimensional data, then to segregate some data which is present in a two dimensional space, I require straight line. I require a straight line which can classify them into two different classes. For example, I can always put the straight line like this. It's a two dimensional data, so I can classify them using a straight line like this. So I can think that these points which are below the straight line, they will fall into particular category, particular class, and the straight lines, I mean the points which are there on the above of the straight line, they will fall into another class. So accordingly, I can segregate them into two different classes based upon the position of those data points. And obviously, one may argue that this straight line approximation may not be perfect in certain sense. So in that case, you could also consider some curvature so that it can be represented properly. So instead of considering the straight line, one can also think of making a point like this. I mean, suppose somebody may think that, okay, this is the nature, and accordingly, the data points which are above this curve, above this arc, is falling in a particular category. Suppose they are OBs, and the points which are below this curve, they are not OBs. So accordingly, I can classify them into two different classes. But simplistically, I can say that a straight line can do this purpose for linear regression kind of thing. For two dimensional data. Now, if I have a three dimensional data, suppose I do have to count the age, the height, and the weight, you know, to classify the people into two different categories, height, weight, and age. So, based upon that, I would say whether the person is obese or not. So, in that case, since I have a data in three dimension, so under this condition, so one particular straight line, neither the straight line nor the data point nor the single point will be suffice. So in this case, I require a plane. So one plane should be there in the 3D space, and all the data points which are above the plane, so we can consider them to be included into a particular set, and all the data points which are there just beneath the plane, I can consider them to be included into some other set. So to segregate the data points, to classify the data points on a 3D plane, so we require a plane. So let me summarize. So if the data point, I think it will be better if I write it down over here. So if we have a one-dimensional data point, 1D data point, then the classifier will be point classifier. To the point classifier. If it's a 2D data point, then it should be line classifier, I should say. If not straight line, but any curvature, I should mention line classifier. Maybe a curvature, but line. One line can only segregate. And on the other hand, if we have a 3D data point, then that can be classified through a plane. So this is known as a plane classifier. So I can segregate the data points in three dimension into different classes. And beyond 3D, because in most of the cases, as you know, the number of data points we can have dimension might be 4, 5, 6, even large. So under this case, the classifier is possible for us to draw this perpendicular on a 2D plane. So anyway, so theoretically we can say that for the data point higher than the 3D, so the classifier will be hyperplane classifier. So let me go back to what I am saying regarding the SVM classification. As I was mentioning, the SVM classifier algorithm, so there are basically three steps. The first one is start with the relatively lower dimension. So if I consider the data point to be single dimensional, so it will be 1, d is equal to 1. And then you have to move the data to a higher dimension. So from single dimension to 2D or single to 3D. And then we have to find the support vector classifier. But how to make this judgment? In which dimension I need to put the data point? So in order to decide this one, the point number two, in order to decide in which dimension you are going to, for the decision, SVM uses a function which is called kernel function. Kernel function to systematically find out the SVC. The support vector classified in higher dimension. Now, if I consider a polynomial kind of kernel, which can systematically increase the dimension by setting the d, then the degree of the polynomial kernel is known as the radial basis function kernel, which is the most popular one. However, there is one problem with this radial basis function kernel. That means its dimension could have been as high as infinity. Under this condition, what can be done is it acts like a weighted nearest neighbor model. That means, once again, if I draw the distribution, suppose these are the points. Suppose these are the points. And there are certain data points over here. Accordingly, the radial basis function kernel will operate. Now it behaves like a weighted nearest neighbor model. That means this forms a cluster, as you understand. This is belonging to a particular set, a particular class, this thing. These data points, so they are belonging to a particular class, and these data points, they are belonging to another class. Now, whenever some new testing data has arrived, suppose the testing data has arrived over here, so this is the testing point. Now, you have to classify whether it belongs to this particular class or it belongs to that particular class. In doing that, what this RPF kernel does is it uses the weighted neighbor model. Weighted nearest neighbor model. So this model is being utilized, which says that whenever the new data point has been inserted into the system for the testing purpose, then the corresponding distance means in the d dimension, if the data points are drawn in d dimension, then we have to find out the distance in d dimension. So the corresponding distance is measured from each of the data points, from this point to this point, from this point to this point, and so on, and from this point to the other points as well.
And
the closest observations will have more influence rather than the farthest. In other words, I can say that whenever the new data point has been inserted, is identified by this. Suppose I think it will be better if I write down the. Suppose this is x1, this is x2. I should mention the axis, x1 and x2. And new data point has been inserted over here. Now, to make a decision whether this data point, this testing point, whether it belongs to class 1 or class 2, what is done under RVF kernel is this weighted nearest neighbor model is imposed, and accordingly, the distance from this testing point to each of these training data sets are measured. That means distance from this black to this green, this black to this green, and so on, and from the distance between this black to this red and this black to this red, and so on. So this distance is measured, and the closest observation, that means these samples, these data sets, which are closest to the training point or nearest neighbor, I should say, these closest observations or nearest neighbors, so they should have the more influence. So that is an important point to remember. The closest observation or the nearest neighbor closest observation or nearest neighbor, they will have more influence and the furthest observation or the furthest neighbor, they will have less influence on the testing data point. And accordingly, this data point is included either in set number 1 or set number 2, or depending upon this particular influence. And this particular model is known as a weighted nearest neighbor model. So I think we have discussed a little bit on this classifier model. In fact, we precise, I have started with discussing on the bias variance trade-off, which is a very important and popular notion in machine learning technology. We always want to minimize the bias as much as possible, so that it can replicate the model, either the straight line model or linear model or the nonlinear model. It should replicate the x and y properly. But unfortunately, for linear regression, it is quite apparent that the bias value is pretty large, and that you don't want to do. So accordingly, we have made a squiggly line approximation, in which case you have seen that the bias could have been minimized to some extent. But this is true only for the training data set. However, for the testing data set, this squiggly line approximation, so they perform terribly bad. And as a matter of fact, the variance is pretty large. Variance means what? Variance means the performance of this machine learning algorithm, or the performance of this classification, or the performance of this particular regression technique in under several conditions, under the testing condition, under the training condition. Now, if the performance is consistent with the defined sets of data, then I should say that the variability is less, or less variability, or less variance. And I've already given you the example that suppose you are attending for any examination, a semester examination or any examination after attending any course. And if it is found that your performance is very much dependent on the question paper, that if the question paper is this much, then you can perform better. And if the question paper has been changed from one set to another set, then your performance is not that good. That means your performance is very much dependent upon the testing data, the test, paper. It depends heavily on the test paper. So technically, this is called the high variability or high variance, so which you don't want to have. So accordingly, we can say that this straight line approximation wins as long as the training and testing data is concerned. And however, if I consider training data only, in that case, this squiggly line approximation wins because it provides a very low bias but high variance. And on the other hand, the straight line approximation provides high bias, but the variance is relatively small as compared to the training data set and the testing data set. So it performs moderately both under training and testing data set. So this bias variance classification is one of the important terminology in this machine learning world. And then we have started with the classifier. Initially, I have considered this maximal margin classifier, which is very much sensitive to the outliers in the training data. Now, if the training data, within the training data, if we find there are certain outliers present, then the maximal margin classifier is not at all optimum. So to get rid of that, what we have identified is we can allow certain misclassification so that to a certain extent, this threshold can be kept at a fixed point, because it is not at all possible for us, for any designer, to change the position of the threshold depending upon the value of the outliers always. So since this maximum margin classifier is super sensitive to the outliers in the training data, so to get rid of the problem, so we allow certain misclassification, and so that it's a perfect example of this bias variance trade-off. Now, when we allow this misclassification, the distance between the observations and the threshold is no longer called a margin, rather it's a soft margin, because we allow certain misclassification. Then since it's a soft margin, then we have to identify which one is better, which soft margin is better. There could have been a number of soft margins present. And this comparison is carried out based upon a cross validation to determine how many misclassifications and observations you can allow inside the soft margin, so as to get the best classification. And when this soft margin is there to determine a threshold, then this type of classifier is known as a soft margin classifier, or in other words, it is also known as a support vector classifier. And the support vector classifier can handle the outliers. It can also allow the misclassification, as I mentioned, and certain overlapping classifications. That is fine. However, if there are lots of overlaps, then our purpose will not be solved. To some extent, we can allow misclassification. But if the number of overlapping samples is pretty large, then our purpose of classification is completely lost. So that's why we have to find out a different device, so that these tons of overlaps can be taken care of. And that device is known as the support vector machine. So it can solve this problem. For support vector machine classifier, as I already mentioned, you have to start with a relatively low dimension, maybe with a single dimension depending upon your data. Then you need to go to the higher dimension, and ultimately you have to find the support vector classifier. Now, depending upon the dimension size, whether you are in two dimension or three dimension, the type of the support vector classifier will be different. For example, if you are in two dimension, then one straight line will be good enough. And if you are in three dimension, then you require a plane to segregate the data points into two different classes. And on the other hand, if I have a three dimensional data, then obviously you require I mean, more than three dimension. So in that case, you require a hyperplane and so on. And how to decide in which dimension the performance will be good? So in that case, SVM uses a certain function, which is known as the polynomial cardinal function or cardinal function. And this cardinal function uses a particular mathematical term. So I am not I have not considered these mathematical illustrations in this particular slide or discussion to make it simple. But if you know it in detail, you can consult any standard textbook on this support vector machines or support vector classifier. Then you'll see that this by changing the dimension, the degree of the polynomial can be tuned properly, and we can have what is known as radial basis function cardinal or RBF cardinal, and which cardinal it considers this weighted nearest neighbor model. That means whenever the new testing point has arrived into the data set, then depending upon the distance between the training data set and the testing data set, the corresponding decision is being taken. Now, suppose this black point has been inserted into the training data set, and the closest observations or the nearest observations, these green observations, these green points, will have more to say as compared to the farthest observation. And accordingly, this black point or this new testing point is classified in accordance with RBF classifier, RBF cardinal. Now, that is all about the classification model, which I have planned to discuss today. Now, I think with this, I can conclude this discussion.